Nick J, Tinashe.
It's the remix.
Y'all.
Why?
When y'all be eating, like, I ain't get lunch that day. You thought I was going to say about fun. But you are tuned into The Morning Drive on WSRF 1580AM. Your boy, 1L DJ, bro. I got the homies, Rebecca, DJ T-Baby, and
no,
Fabi.
I'm not your homie today.
Fabiola, DJ Fab 509.
On break, and I be
What? What are you complaining about?
Anyway,
what?
It is our Health Tuesday today, and, you know, on Health Tuesday, we talk about fitness, wellness, being sexy, and all that good stuff. And we actually have a special guest joining us today. His name is Ovince St. Preux. Now, if that doesn't ring any bells, Ovince St. Preux is a UFC light heavyweight contender currently. And I have to say, bonjour, Mr. St. Preux.
Bonjour,
qui
sont
you? Good morning. How you doing?
Man, I'm good, man. How y'all doing?
We're good.
We're good.
Thank you so much for joining us this morning. Now, you know, to the grand mounio, Ovince St. Preux is a professional athlete. Libatai, c'est ça le fait.
Ça le fait.
Libatai,
Ligoumé.
I remember.
That's what he does.
I sit down with my dad every now and then. I ask him to watch. He's like, ah, qui ça ça y est? C'est sauvage. I'm like, no, dad, it's a sport. My dad used to watch wrestling and he watched boxing. I'm like, just put them together and that's the beginnings of MMA.
Basically, right. If you put that together, that's the gist of it.
I appreciate it. So once again, thank you. Now, if you can introduce yourself to the people, tell them a little bit about yourself. Clearly, you got some Haitian in you.
Yeah, it's Haitian, yeah. My mom spoke to Haiti. I was born and raised in half my life in Miami, a little Haiti area, then moved to Immokalee, which is in the other side of Florida, where neighbors in Fort Myers at. I went to school at the University of Tennessee to play football, played there for 4 years, and after that, just kind of stumbled into mixed martial arts. But pretty much, it's a quick overview of my life.
So you've always been an athlete from, like, day one. Yeah, I'm surprised you didn't say you played soccer at some point.
Oh, yeah, I played soccer, you know, wrestled, played football in high school, ran track in high school. So yeah.
Okay. You had them progressive Haitian parents.
Okay, because them Haitian, à l'église, à l'école, à la caille. Okay, don't play no.
The three L's, right?
Yeah.
L'église, la caille, l'école.
That is it. No, and I was going to say, I was small in high school, so I didn't get the chance to play. All my height came afterwards. All of a sudden, my dad was like, why didn't you play? I'm like, really, dude? Like, you don't remember? I was like 4'11", though? Like, but definitely. Oh, go ahead, fam.
No, I was going to ask, what did your parents say when you started fighting and everything?
It's one of them things, you know, at first they didn't know. My mom, every time she gets off in a fight, and she gets off in a fight, she was like, I was fighting all these white guys. She was like, pull over it. Tout le monde blanc, ça va faire taille. Et pas le fruit, ça va pas aller. Pourquoi on fait mon blanc, ça va pas tout. But they're good with it now. It's just like, you know, my hometown in Immokalee, I get the big Haitian crowd support. And it's crazy, too. It's not only the Haitian people. You got the Mexicans and the Americans, too. They be driving around. The day that I'm fighting, they'll drive around in their car with Haitian flag, just driving around honking all day and waiting for my fight to start.
Mm-hmm. I see now. So, I remember when we first found out that you were competing, because, you know, that was when everyone knew about GSP. And I remember my boy and I, we were talking. He was like, yeah, yo, OSP's going to fight. I'm like, what? No, you're saying the name wrong. Like, it's clearly GSP. He's like, no, it's a Haitian fighter out there. Come see. Now, I think this was back in Strike Force, I think. And he was just like, yo, check out the fight. And that's when I first started seeing it. And I was like, oh, okay, I see you going out with the Haitian flag. So now my question to you is like, you know, why were you just so amped to hype the red and blue? Like, why are you so proud to be Haitian going out there?
Man, it's been something that's been going back in high school. It's just like, you know, before anybody say anything, it'd be like, where you from? You don't need to tell them where you're from. You'd be like, I'm hype, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
It's just something that you just want to rep for real. I mean, I just let people know, it's just like, you know, just because of the culture that I grew up in, the Haitian culture, it's wrong culture. Like a lot of people, you tell them, you come up to a woman and you tell them, you just tell them natural, just regular facts about Haiti, 1804. Mm-hmm. Haiti was the first black nation to break away from slavery. A lot of people don't know that. So my culture is rich in pride and tradition and stuff, and I just want to make everybody be aware of that. And I tell every time somebody asks me something, I always tell everybody a bit of history about something.
Have you ever went to Haiti?
Yeah.
To be honest, no. That's
man.
The bad part.
Oh, wow.
We need to.
But your curl is so cute, though.
Oh,
don't do that, Fabi. We're not doing that this morning.
The girls like to joke around because I, too, have never been to Haiti, and they've lived. So I'm like, you know, they always take shots at us non-being the Haiti Haitians. So, but it doesn't make us any less Haitian.
But you see, I got reasons behind it. The reason is because, you know, with your parents, they used to go to Haiti once or twice a year. I never could go, especially when I got to high school, when my mom really wanted me to go because football, wrestling, and track. And over the summer, I was either at football camp, wrestling track,
okay,
or wrestling camp. Went out to college and playing football at university, that's never going to happen, especially when I got a, you know, school year round, and during the summer, I'm going to, you know, taking summer classes, doing summer workout. But since I've been fighting, I've been trying to get that, you know, that break where I can go. I've just been keeping myself active fighting that it's hard. But I even told my mom one year, I was like, hey, when can we go to Haiti? Well, you can't go right now. And I was like, what are you talking about? Oh, you're too Americanized. You can't go right now. You gotta wait.
Wow.
I'm like, okay.
But where did you learn how to speak Creole? Did she teach you, or, I don't know?
I mean, you know, growing up in a Haitian household, Creole was the first thing you know how to speak. I didn't know how to speak English until my cousins taught me, you know, my older cousins taught me from playing and stuff. But, you know, Creole was the first language, and, I mean, it's not the best, but, you know, I can communicate.
Okay. All right, so Touche taking on TIC and live, but you know, it works out because they make fun of my Creole too. But you know, my fatigue form, I'm fixing it up now. French, don't get me started on French. That's where I'm at. You holler at the women.
You see, his Creole is so cute.
I mean, you need to see, she's just flipping her hair. Oh my god, thank you, Fabiola. Thank you. He's not here to holler at you. See, I can't do
it. Let her flirt over the phone. Don't do that.
So now, since being an athlete was always in your blood, like, how was the transition going from football, track, soccer, and wrestling into MMA? Because now you're getting punched.
You know, it wasn't that bad. I wrestled in high school, and playing football, I started playing football late, but I picked up really fast at it. And, you know, me being Haitian, growing up, usually when you watch the kids with your Haitian parents, you usually watch some type of karate movie. So.
Mm-hmm.
Watching Van Damme or Chuck Norris, or watching wrestling. So just naturally, you wanted I wanted to develop a good button tick. So I just got into it. I got through playing football. I wanted to keep myself active and shape. Mm-hmm. And one thing led to another. Started training and didn't know realize how fast I was picking up on everything. And next thing you know, I'm fighting and had my first fight. And usually when you have a first fight like that, I was like, man, I want to do this again. So started sticking with it and, end up being really good at it. Now I'm fighting for the UFC.
And that's what I was going to say. So now going from, everyone starts off in little backyard brawls, yeah, and then you get into, the mid-level ones. But how'd you feel when you got the call for coming from Strikeforce, but then Dana White, UFC, gave you a call? How was it feeling like you're going to hit the main stage?
I mean, it was a blessing within itself, just for the simple fact that I was already, making a name for myself with Strikeforce. But when Strikeforce got, fought out by the UFC, Zuffa, just making that transition, I knew I was going to be there. I knew I was going to be fighting in the UFC. Just, I went 6-1 in Strikeforce, and I was like, okay, just a matter of time. But when I got that phone call for my first fight, it was unreal. Just because, and it was crazy, too, because my first fight was in Jersey. Mm-hmm. And as I'm walking out, I'm coming out with my Haitian flag and stuff. And all I heard was people screaming in the background. I'm like, man, who are these people? They come screaming extra loud. People don't like me in this negative world. So I went to fight as I'm walking to the locker room. I see this Haitian crowd talking about Haitian. I turned around and I threw my flag at him. And he followed me on Instagram. And he was like, bro, I promise you made my year. It was like, this is my first time going to a UFC fight. When you came out with that Haitian flag, I lost my mind. I said, I think I cried. And then after that, we kind of responded back and forth on Instagram. But I was like, man, after that, I was thinking to myself, man, that's definitely what's up. That's why every time now, every single fight, no matter where I go, you always see me carry my Haitian flag.
It's like honestly seeing a part of ourselves up there, because you're so used to seeing whether it be the American guys, the Brazilians, Hispanic, or yeah, the Mexican. I mean, even back when Tito Ortiz was out there, he had his flags up. So it was like, yo, I've always wanted to see. You always imagine that red and blue up there. So the first couple of times, you're like, wait a minute, is that a Haitian dude walking up there? So you're like, first of all, it lets you look to your mom and dad like, ah, we Haitian fell too, mom. So it's about some of our one I've had. So yeah, we can do it too.
Yeah, but it's one of the things, when it happened, I was like, my uncle actually got the flag, and I was like, I came home, and I was like, I need a Haitian flag. He was like, what are you talking about? I said, man, all these folks talking about their flag, I need my flag, too. And sometimes it would be like, my uncle would be like, oh, man, well, I'm in ballet club. I said, man, yeah. And I get mad, but at the same time, it's just one of the things where, even with me carrying the flag, and been a bit of a thing where, I fight, so I basically fight with small gloves, no shirt, no shoes on. Mm-hmm. But you can start seeing the artwork in my body. This transition into everything that's on me is about my culture. Mm-hmm. So, going down across my chest, it says Bunjin Bunjusa, and I got a big palm tree, and a palm tree got the ocean in the background, got the mountains and stuff, and I got a tattoo of Haiti up under my bicep. But it's just me showing people who I am, where, yeah, I come from. So
now, a big part of being Haitian, we know, is representing the artifacts or speaking clear, but it's the Munji. How does eating the Haitian food translate into your training and your diet, or what it should be at least?
Mm-hmm. Every time I get through with a fight, I usually go home right away. I have to. Mm-hmm. Just because if I don't go home, my mom will get mad at me. My last fight, not this fight, I had a fight about 3 weeks ago, but the fight before that, I lost that fight by decision, fighting this guy named Ryan Bader. Mm-hmm. Pretty good guy. I didn't have the proper training camp that I needed to do, but I didn't eat the proper food I needed to. My mom kept on complaining.
It gives you fuss. You feel about fuss.
That leg can be good, though.
Man, man, my sister-in-law, she'd be making that legging with that crab in it. Oh, my God.
But what is your, like, typical training food look like? Like, what you're supposed to eat to be a fighter?
Oh, okay. If I break it down to you, pretty much 2.5 months out before my fight, the only thing I really eat is either grilled chicken, grilled fish, brown rice, sweet potato, quinoa, or the vegetables that I eat are usually broccoli, asparagus, and, you know, just broccoli, asparagus, any type of greens. And I make me a green juice that have, like, kale, spinach, you know, flaxseed, ginger. If I eat avocados because those are healthy fats.
Okay, that's a little Haitian in there, some avocado. Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But everything that I eat is wheat bread. So that's pretty much what I eat 2 weeks before the fight. I don't drink any. I have a hard time drinking soda right now, so I don't drink any soda right now. All I primarily drink either water, coconut water, Pedialyte, just to keep me hydrated. And it's probably a month out before the fight, I have to start drinking about 2 gallons of water a day. But that's basically my essential diet. I can break it down even further, mm-hmm. but that's just basically the bulk of it.
Okay, so I clearly heard no. There was no fritai. Pat game my mule in there. It was just no.
Nah, I mean, to be honest, if I'm fighting and I happen to go home, I'm basing my. If I'm going home, say if I'm going home on a Monday, 2 weeks prior before I go home, I'll base my whole entire diet. I'll diet to the extreme just because I need that full day where I can eat my Haitian food.
Oh, okay, so it'll balance out.
Yeah, but Haitian food is not that bad, though.
Man, not on the home-cooked meal. They just got to be careful of that grass when they put that tomato
that oil.
In there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, it's not like eating a cheeseburger. A cheeseburger, if I eat that, I can feel that the next day. Mm-hmm. Haitian food, if I eat it, I don't have to feel it the next day. You know, you see Haitian people cook chicken. They get a sick one. They get some vinegar. And make sure that thing is
clean. Let them know who listening that Haitian food is on point. So now, what does the training regimen look like? Did it differ anything from when you were back in wrestling and in football, or is it just a whole nother thing training for an MMA fight?
It's the hardest thing I ever did in my life. Don't lie. I mean, once it comes to the diet, I never dieted so clean in my life. I never did so much cardio in my life. I do so much running now that I really didn't do in football. So I don't only run for distance, I run to sprint too. Working out. I always got to maintain my weight because I got to cut weight. But just waking up in the morning, if I wake up in the morning, I do boxing. For boxing, I go to see my strength and conditioning coach and seeing him. I go to, you know, see my chiropractor so he can line my body back up. Then I have, you know, one-on-one with my trainer. When I have that, I have, BJJ class and MMA class. So I can be training anywhere from, you know, 5 to 8 hours a day, 8 being my long day, and 5 being my short day.
And go ahead, Rebecca. I know you have a question.
Oh, the question I had for you was, how is cutting weight like?
Like, are you worried about injuries and everything like that?
Not necessarily. Cutting weight, usually people got different ways of doing it. You just got to get it down to a science. Me personally, as long as I diet the week before weigh-ins, if I'm under 220, I just cut my carbs out and the weight will just fall off of me. But sometimes I put myself in situations where, you know, I have to cut more than I want. But cutting weight is not fun. I mean, theoretically, all I'm doing is dehydrating my body, making weight, and rehydrating my body.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's not what you're supposed to do, but the only reason I do it is because it's either me fight at 205 or me fight at, you know, heavyweight. And heavyweight, you got guys weighing 290 cutting down to 265 the next day, they weigh 280. And I'm walking around 220, 225. I'm not going to fare too much against them, and they hit hard, really hard.
Have you ever trained with a heavyweight?
I have. Everything a heavyweight do, when they punch you, kick you, everything. It hurts really bad. But the thing is, they have no cardio. So, running around for a little while
and they're gone.
But that's the thing, though. If I'm running around for a little bit, it only takes one punch, one kick. That can stop me. That can stop certain people.
I have a question. It's going to sound a little bit silly, but when you get hurt in your face, does it really hurt? Because a reason I can't really watch, you know, boxing, because I'm like, oh my gosh, you know, they're hitting each other's face, they're hitting each other. I'm like, oh my, oh, are you serious? Are they really fighting like that? Well, does it really hurt? Or, well,
they just pretend. They pretend the blood is fake.
No, because how can you handle that? You know, somebody punching you all the time. Did you get tired? Like, okay, stop punching me, you know, and cuss at them.
You feel it at times. It's just when it does happen, you feel it, but you don't feel it just because you got so much adrenaline and stuff. And it's just like you get in a fight and you start looking and you be like, where did this come from? Why my face hurt? You don't feel anything probably after the fight because you still have all that adrenaline pumping, and that's when you end up feeling it after the fight. But during the fight, you don't feel it. If you do happen to feel it, you're gonna be hurting really. It's gonna be hurting really bad.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes a lot of people don't feel it because they're waking up and being like, "What happened?" That means you got knocked out.
Okay.
That's what you don't want. You don't want to not feel it, because that's when you wake up like, "Oh, okay, I lost already." So I was going to say, you know, if you're getting hit that much, you probably need to train a little bit better. You should. The object is not to get hit that many times.
The object is to have a better game plan and not to get hit.
Do they have, like doctors or, how do you call them, paramedics on scene just in case something happened or just in case, you know, you start bleeding out? You know, do they have that kind of, like, medical staff there?
Yeah, they always have a doctor right there by the ring after the fight. You get seen by a doctor, they ask you, are you okay? You know, do your hands hurt? Do your eyes hurt? They check your eyes, make sure you don't have a concussion. And they automatically, if your fight goes all three rounds, they automatically suspend you for 30 days.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. I didn't know that.
You know, they automatically suspend you for 30 days. Because, you know, a lot of times if you go three rounds, that means you got hit. So that also means with getting hit, you probably had a concussion that you didn't know about. So, you know, they suspend you for all three rounds, and not all three rounds, all 30 days. And if you get knocked out, they probably suspend you for 60 to 90 days, depending on how bad the knockout was. But they also send you to the hospital to get a CAT scan too. And the beauty about all of that, everything that goes on right there, they pay for all of that.
Okay.
See, because I know the argument that, I know I use it as well, that mixed martial arts is safer than some of the other combat sports because of the different ways the fight can end, and clearly because they have these regulations to keep you guys safe.
Oh, yeah. I tell everybody, against boxing. I love boxing. I love watching boxing. But the only way to win in boxing is either knock out or, you know, beat somebody by a decision. If you knock them out, that means you have some type of concussion. If you go all 12 rounds, I mean, you probably have some type of concussion, because constantly getting hit in the head like that, it develops concussion. It can be like at 1% and 2% and 3%, but it's gradually building up. The thing about mixed martial arts is if you're not defending yourself, they're going to stop the fight. They've been in a fight one time. I didn't throw one punch. I threw a kick that he blocked, and I took him down and I submitted him.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I had fights like that. And then the thing about boxing too, they give you the 8 count. You get knocked down, they give you the 8 count. So you get knocked down, that means somebody hits you, and they hit you, and you get a concussion at 30%. When you get back up, you fight, you get hit again. That concussion was from 30%. Now it's going up to like 60%. And you get knocked down again, so you just gradually start building up.
Okay.
So people look at mixed martial arts as, you know, it's dangerous. It's safer than football.
Mm-hmm.
Football, you hit somebody, and there have been times when I played football, I hit somebody, and I was like, man, I don't remember the last time I played, and I'm still in the game, making tackles. You're just going off of reflexes or what you know. So mixed martial arts is just like I said, if you're not defending yourself, they'll stop the fight.
right. I know we have to take this quick commercial break. When we come back, we'll ask you a little bit more about your plans in the UFC, who you want to see fight next. Of course, congratulate you on your last knockout win. So we'll be right back to the Morning Drive on WSRF 1580 AM.
Talk crazy, I pull up on the late. R.B. the Nate, dog. I had to regulate.
Public service announcement. Why my rent, man? Why rent, man? Me go.
Bro, stand to the left. Love. My wrist, stand to the right. Lil' mama, she keep looking at me. I'ma knock the f*** out like fight night. Hit it with a left, hit it with a right. I'ma knock the f*** out like fight night. Beat it with a left, hit it with the right. I'ma knock the f*** out like fight night. If you know me, know this ain't my first way. Certified everywhere, ain't got a print resume. Take out L.A. Talk crazy, I pull up underlay. R.P. to Nate, dog, I had to regulate. Pocket rocket fire, watch him disintegrate. This is short long, coming on the industry. Third line state, all on my dinner plate. Your main says she wanna make a rich. I can never be a broke, cause I can never get along with them. Always been hated since a little. And forever, gotta deal with it. Broke, stand to the left. My rich, stand to the right. Lil' mama, she keep looking at me. I'ma knock the f*** out like fight night. Hit it with a left, hit it with a right. I'ma knock the f*** out like fight night. Hit it with a left, hit it with the right. I'ma knock the f*** out like fight night.
Float like a butterfly, sting like a bee. Rumble, young rumble. Lil' mama wanna like me in the sheets. Ice Cube, knock it out like D-Bo. Now who's that talking that gangsta? Some they gon' kick it.
The Morning Drive on WSR 1580 AM, and good morning to our 9 o'clock listeners. We are jealous of you because you know you get to wake up at 9 o'clock. But
what's going on?
I just want to tell the broke people to stand to the left, mm-hmm. and my rich homies stand to the right. I don't have that much. I'm broke.
Okay, got it.
Once again, we have a special guest. Who's on the line with us today, Fabi?
Our guest today is...
Even her voice is blushing. Like, I hate it.
Are you serious? He's cute, though, but, you know. Hey, boy. Ovince Saint-Preux. But, you know, in the French, you say Saint-Preux. Mm-hmm. Okay. He's a UFC light...
Light heavyweight. I told you she was going to mess it up.
Fighter. Light heavyweight fighter.
Now, once again, we have our boy Ovince Saint-Preux on the line. Good morning, Ovince.
Good morning.
Hi, Ovince.
I'm going to turn off her mic.
How you doing?
How are you?
His mom could hear us. Can you stop hollering at the man while mommy's in the
she
room?
She just said, hey.
I just said, hey. Hey, Ovince.
So, for those who didn't catch you in the beginning, once again, we have UFC light heavyweight, a contender, Ovince Saint-Preux on the line with us. He just recently broke in the top 10, if I'm not mistaken, the top 10 rankings off of your last fight, the UFC Fight Night 56. Now, I did want to ask, as far as your fight so far in your whole career, what do you think was your most exciting fight?
My last fight, just because of the person who I fought. Shogun, you know, he was the former Preux champ. He was the former UFC champ. And he'd been in the game for so long, like, and just beating him catapulted my career, but also it was a monumental moment in my career just because of the name Shogun. So I would say that. And I'm the only person that ever knocked him out in the first round.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. Okay. What do you usually do after you win a fight? Like, what do you do? Like, do you celebrate? Do you go and eat some delicious espoir? What do you do?
Try to get my butt home on the floor as quick as possible so I can get some delicious espoir from ladies.
Do you go clubbing? You know, you hit the clubs and celebrate?
Usually after a fight, like, this case I was in Brazil, so... I was not going to go out by myself in Brazil.
No. Not, especially not knocking out their hero. You can't.
Yeah, after I did that, I was like, let me hurry up and try to get out of the country. but I just went back to Knoxville, kind of hung out for a little bit, Still kept my diet pretty clean, and just went home, came home. Like I said, usually when I come home, all I want to do is just kind of relax, just, you know, hang out with my parents, spend as much time with my parents and my nephews and nieces.
I said, that sounds like a typical Haitian family, just huge, a whole lot of y'all. As far as your fights, what would you say do you learn the most from, a loss or from a win?
I usually learn from a loss. Even the fight that I fought against Ryan Bader, that fight, I didn't really commit myself like I needed to. You know, I was on a five-fight win streak, and I got a little complacent. That's the thing about, you know, playing sports or playing like an individual type of sport. If you're doing really good, you can get a little bit complacent, but that's what happened to me. I got complacent. I wasn't training as much as I needed to, and, you know, I lost that fight. I didn't lose fast, but it kind of humbled me again to where, you know, I started training, and when I started back training, I was drilling, I was pushing myself more, and, you know, I was always taking that extra step. I was the last one at the gym. Leaving the gym, I was the first one to get there. So, and it kind of showed in the Shogun fight. That whole entire week, I was calm. People was like, are you nervous? I'm like, no, I'm fine. And a lot of people was giving me the eye like, okay, yeah, you're going to get messed up. And I came out there, and I finished the fight in 34 seconds. Had the whole crowd pretty much quiet.
Wow.
Yeah, it was silent. And I was going to say, you were a late replacement. How much time did you have between finding out the previous fighter stepped out of the fight and you were getting the fight instead?
Either 8 or 9 days, I'm not sure. But even before that, I was on the card initially. I was the co-main event. And I was supposed to fight a guy, Feijiao, a month before that. Mm-hmm. Probably 6 weeks before that fight, they switched my opponent. Then, you know, 8 days before I fight, they switched my opponent again. And, you know, I had three different opponents in a matter of 2 months. So yeah, it was crazy. It was a late replacement, but, you know, things happen for a reason, and it was a blessing in disguise.
And what a lot of people don't realize is the difficulty of having your opponent changed on you, because sometimes your whole training camp is built mm-hmm. around one fighter, but then you get a different fighter. So did you feel like you were completely prepared for Shogun, or you're just like, dang, they gave me a ground specialist who can knock people out, so what am I going to do?
I was a little nervous. Shogun has a name behind him. He's been in the game for so long. He fought the Miss Martial Arts. He fought everybody. But at the same time, he just stylistically, the matchup, it was better for me just because I knew what I was capable of. And, you know, he's the one that... He was fighting more of a boxer, and I'm more of a kickboxer, you know, wrestler. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, he was fighting a right-handed person, and I'm left-handed. So, you know, I went out there, and his whole training camp, he was getting ready for a right-handed fighter. And, you know, 8 days away from the fight, he had to change the style. So I didn't put a lot of pressure on me. I was like, all the pressure's on him. I'm fighting in Brazil. I'm fighting in his backyard. He won a good performance, and, like, everybody was talking about Shogun this, Shogun that, and I was kind of in the background. So I was like, you know, all the pressure's on him. I think I'll be perfectly fine. So I came out there. I felt good. I always told myself during the fight, I thought I was nervous. It was never that I was nervous. I was anxious. So I went out there and did what I needed to do.
So how do you prefer to end a fight when you're fighting someone? Do you like to knock out, or do you like to submission, do a little wrestling move?
I want to know what the submission is, actually. Like, when somebody wins by submission, what does that even mean?
A submission could be a choke or joint manipulation. What I mean by a choke, it can be a triangle choke or a naked choke, basically cutting a blood vessel, cutting the blood going through your head, and you pass out.
Oh, wow.
And the choke is not that bad, actually. It's not that bad. So if you get choked out and you fall asleep and you wake up, it's equivalent to taking a three-hour nap.
It's a little too good, though. You come back, you're refreshed.
Yeah. It's almost like, I'm going to describe a choke to you. A choke is resetting your computer and refreshing everything.
Ah, okay.
It resets your whole entire body, but if you hold on to it long enough, you can do, that's when the damage starts happening. And a submission is a joint manipulation. Either me getting your elbow, popping it out of place, me putting your shoulders at a 90-degree angle and cranking it. Yeah, you can get a submission with, you know, your elbow, shoulders, your back, your knees, your ankle. So.
I'll demonstrate one on the ladies.
Yeah,
if you
he one that was demonstrating on her. Now. Oh my goodness!
One of my favorites is the Kimura. I got you. I mean, I'll show you a Kimura.
And what is your favorite? Knockout, a submission, or decision? Like Rebecca's question.
Typically a knockout. If I can get a head kick knockout, that'd be good. But typically a knockout.
Yeah, I think head kicks have to be most. Like they have to be most excited. Other than the rampaging someone, because the rampage slams where he knocks people out are great. So besides the Crow Cop knockout kicks or the rampage, crazy.
I'll definitely go for Crow Cop knockout kicks. That's you know, like I said, just getting icy and stuff. All you want to do is just watch karate. You grew up watching karate movies. All you want to do is just kick. Every Haitian that you come upon,
they know how to kick. Yep, I'm a kicker.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
So do you have like a special move or not? Like not in wrestling, you know how they in wrestling they have a special move. But do you have like a special move like you know it's gonna kill them?
My kick. The thing about me playing football, I develop a lot of power. My hips are extremely strong. So when I kick, I don't care if you block you. I don't care if you put your hands up there to block it. My kick is strong enough to break your arm, so that's why a lot of times I like to kick.
All right, so here's a very Haitian question for you. When you go to fights, do you bring the l'huile masquite with you? Because afterwards, you got to rub it the joint and the leg. You know, I know your mom's been throwing it in the bag when you don't see it, so you just rub on the leg. You know.
Oh, man. My mom actually tried to get me to use it. I was like, my mom and my
Don't slip on them gum wounds, yo. They know what they're saying.
Oh man, I got this cast in my hand right now from hitting Shogun. I got a slightly torn tendon in my hand, and my mom, because I'm pointing this shit, counting me up a little bit, and I was like, "Mom, oh, come on, man."
She's going to rub on it. She's going to pull it, and okay. You're going to be good.
When is your next fight?
It hasn't been set yet. I'm hoping either sometime in March or April. Oh, I just told him I wanted to take a break. I needed to take a break because pretty much all my fights have been 2 months. And I told my trainer, I was like, look, I got a life too.
See, I'm thinking, so, you know, you were on a good streak. You got probably, I'll say, 2 L's to avenge. I know probably Giga Musasi back you in the strike for us, and then most recently Bader. So how far along do you think your shot at the belt is?
Man, you know, I don't think it's as long as I'm consistent, as long as I keep on doing what I need to do, I think I should be good. And it's just the fact that, probably if I'm doing what I'm doing right now, give me a good 2 years. 2 years would be the most.
And is there any area of your game you think that you still have to improve on, or one area that you think you could probably take to the next level?
Say that again?
Is there any particular area of your game, like your whether it's your submission game or your wrestling, is there any part that you feel like you have to take to the next level or that has, you know, room for a little improvement?
Think about it, mixed martial arts needs work. And every part of my game needs work. My striking can end up being better. My wrestling can end up being better. My jiu-jitsu can end up being better. So it's one of the sports that constantly evolving. So it never really just stops. So my game definitely can improve in all three aspects of mixed martial arts. So that's why I'm in the gym day in and day out trying to get better.
Okay. Do you have any questions for anybody who wants to be an athlete like you?
Advice,
man. What did I say?
Questions.
Oh my gosh.
we're advice, asking questions.
Advice. Any coffee, you guys? Any advice?
It's hard when you get started off. I'm not gonna lie. Cause when you first get started with something, it's hard. Cause when I started off, I'm not gonna lie, it was hard. I was fighting for nothing, and the thing is, you got to keep on pushing yourself. But at the same time, you got to think yourself, if you're doing any type of sport and you're an athlete, you got to think your body as being a sports car, fast sports car. You're not just going to put anything into the sports car, which is regular gas, anything. You're going to put the Supreme in it. You're going to also constantly get you tuned up. And you're going to also, want to make sure that car performs to its full capacity. And that being said I try to treat my body like a sports car. And I'm eating the right food because if I eat the right food, I can train longer and train better.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, I make sure my body is properly healed. I'm doing a cold tub. I'm seeing my chiropractor. I'm constantly stretching. I'm taking yoga. I do all of that. So it's just not only you just go in there and train, but you got to do everything outside of training, eating correctly, and doing all of that, and you'd be perfectly fine.
Okay. What we usually do when we have a guest, we usually take pictures with them, but unfortunately, we weren't able to do that with you. Can you take a selfie and tag us in it?
Ignore that one.
No,
I'm pretty serious.
No, I'm serious. Take a selfie and tag us in it, The Morning Drive, on Facebook or on Twitter. Can you do that?
All right, I got it.
Thank you, Ovince.
I know it is 9:30. We got to let you go. We hear Mama in the background. So what we got to do is when we sign off with the guests, we ask them to say Unali. It's a great way to get them excited, get ready for the day, and especially, to support Ovince. Hit them up on Instagram. It's 003_OSP. Hit them up, follow, and of course, pay attention to next fight.
Don't forget our selfie.
I'm done. So on the count of three, I need you to give the people a hearty Unali. 1, 2, 3.
Unali.
Yes.
All right. Thank you so much. Once again, that was Ovince St. Preux, UFC light heavyweight contender, on the line with us. You have a great day.
I'm waiting for my selfie now.
I'm done.
I got it.
Thank you.
All right, have a great one, Ovince. Thank you so much.
All right.
So, thank you. We had fun with Ovince. It's what he does. It's a lifestyle choice.
No, it's fun. You
know that's how it started, dude. That's how you say it. But thank you so much. Them Haitians out there represent us. He's on a big stage, that red and blue. It brought a lot of attention to us. So definitely was happy to have him on our Health Tuesday.